Welcome to Hard Talk. I'm Stephen Sacker. With Donald Trump's efforts to overturn the presidential election running out of road, world attention is increasingly focused on President-elect Biden's vision of America's role in the world. Will he revert back to the policies and assumptions that defined the Obama years? Are there lessons to be learned from Trump's disruption of foreign policy norms? Well, my guest is Anthony Gardner, U.S. ambassador to the EU under Obama. What should the world expect from President Biden? Anthony Gardner, welcome to Hard Talk.
Thank you.
Let's begin by looking at the names that have been put forward by Joe Biden to be key players in his foreign policy and national security team. That is Tony Blinken, who we understand will be Secretary of State, and Jake Sullivan will be his national security advisor. Both of them key players in the foreign policy machine of Barack Obama. Does this mean we are reverting back to what was?
Well, first of all, they are both exceptional human beings, exceptional individuals with a lot of experience. I've known Tony Blinken for 52 years, and I worked with him twice in the National Security Council and later, obviously, under the Obama presidency. And I've seen him in the trenches in some very difficult situations. And not only does he have the right skills and experience, he's also a very decent human being. And everyone in government who's worked with him would say that. Those are really rare skills. And I've worked with Jake and have very high regard for him. But no, to answer your question, this is not going to be, in my view, speaking as a private citizen, this will not be Obama 3.0. It's got to be different. You know, Trump isn't going to go away. It's not in his character. And Trumpism, unfortunately, has not been defeated. A lot of water under the bridge. So things will have to be different. There will not be perhaps enormous bandwidth for foreign policy. And in the foreign policy that we seek to achieve, we're going to have to be very, very focused in trade and non-trade issues as well. So you'll see a different way of going about things.
Interesting you say that you don't think there'll be that much bandwidth for foreign policy. That comes as something of a surprise, given that Joe Biden, in his five decades of public service, has exhibited a great and lasting interest in foreign policy. He's going to put that on the shelf, is he?
No, I didn't say on the shelf. But, and of course, yes, he has enormous experience in foreign policy. And that's one of the reasons I joined the campaign from day one. I'm just saying that the pressure of events will be such that most of the attention will be on fixing enormous damage domestically. And we're going to have a lot to fix in terms of shoring up our democratic system, which has really been, in my view, undermined by this president over 4 years. And we have a pandemic that's raging and a lot of other things. So I think the focus is going to be clearly on domestic policy.
Is Joe Biden going to try to unpick everything Donald Trump has done in the foreign policy arena?
If you're asking, will many of the things that Donald Trump did, will they be unwound? I think the answer is yes, on climate and on foreign policy, for sure, and very quickly, and quite rightly so. I think it's an outrage that we have walked away from the Paris Climate Accords. I would expect there to be an announcement pretty soon that we not only rejoin, but that we do everything we can to help the world clamber out of the deeper hole that we have all dug ourselves into. But on NATO, on trade, on working with allies and working within the multilateral system, I think you see a radical change of emphasis. That doesn't mean that everything that Donald Trump did will be unpicked. Look, there are a few achievements, including the fact that three Arab states have recognized Israel. So let's admit it. That is an achievement. So I'm not saying everything, but a lot of things will be undone.
We'll get back to the specifics, particularly in the Middle East, but on your arena, Europe, I'm mindful that you served as U.S. ambassador to the EU for some years under Barack Obama. In the arena of Europe, there are going to be real efforts, it seems, to try to restore positive, warm relations between the United States and European allies who have looked with some disquiet at what happened under Donald Trump. How easy is that going to be?
Well, no one's pretending it's going to be a walk in the park. We have a lot of challenges ahead of us. But I can tell you the emphasis will be dramatically different. Let's start with the EU. Donald Trump jumped the rails after 60 years of bipartisan foreign policy in the United States, supporting European integration, supporting the EU particularly. So I would have agreed with 90% of what my predecessors, Republican and Democrat, would have thought and said about the EU. This administration said, you know what, we don't need Europe, we don't need the EU, we'll do it alone. We'll negotiate bilaterally, transactionally, and we will deal with China alone. And worse than that, try to undermine the EU, asking for more Brexits, expecting for more Brexits, and in fact insulting a few allies, particularly Germany, out of pique, because they sell too many products in the United States. All of that will change dramatically, and for a good reason, because the United States, and this is what counts, the real acid test, the United States can get more done by working with its allies, including on trade and including on China. Look, the EU has an enormous single market that represents a lot of leverage. Why we haven't worked with the EU to bring China to the table, to reform the WTO rules, and address its abusive trade and investment practices, I really cannot understand.
Do you think the Europeans want as close and warm a relationship with the United States going forward as they have had in the past? I'm just mindful, for example, that Emmanuel Macron in France says that the message of what happened over the last 4 years is that Europe must be much more self-reliant, much less inclined to look to the United States for its overall security guarantees. There are those also in Europe who see Joe Biden, who is, after all, a pretty elderly president, and think he may only be around for one term. We're not sure what comes next. Donald Trump and his associates still have more than 70 million votes cast in the last election. Should we really rely on the United States to be our closest ally in the future?
Well, Stephen, there are no guarantees in life. Who knows what will happen in 4 years? You're right, the threat is there that we will return to the demagogic populism that we've experienced in the United States.
Well, you call it a threat. I'm not calling it a threat. I'm simply saying that Europeans can no longer take for granted the sort of multilateral approach that you and Joe Biden are clearly keen to offer.
Absolutely. I understand completely. And, you know, having resided in Europe for 29 years of my life, I actually understand that. But I can tell you, the first part of your question is, are Europeans happy? Are they, taking this as good news? Absolutely. I've gotten a lot of, messages from member states and the Commission saying this is great news. It's time that we actually go back as we were before, negotiating, moving forward on security and trade and other foreign policy issues. But there is no guarantee. But, the conclusion of all of this is that we need to seize the day. We need to seize the day. And I can tell you, in the work that was going on during the past 6 months of the Biden campaign on foreign policy, there were a few ideas that were really shaping our work. And one was, what is doable quickly, within 2 years, relatively uncontroversial, no academic proposals. And it's very important that we prove the case to our domestic populations that working with allies within the rules, within the multilateral institutions, yields better results for our people. That's the key test.
There are decisions to be made about different priorities in Europe, too, for the Biden administration. We know that Mr. Biden himself and Tony Blinken and Jake Sullivan over years have expressed their concern about Brexit. They felt that it was going to weaken the European Union, but in particular weaken a key ally, the United Kingdom. But Brexit has happened. It is a reality, and the United States must decide whether it really invests a massive amount in building a strong relationship with Brexit Britain, or whether its first priority is restoring a truly warm and functional relationship with the European Union led by France and Germany. Which is it going to do?
Why is there a choice, Stephen? You're posing it as an either-or. I don't see it that way at all. I see it as a triangle of relationships,
but
all of which...
But it is about priorities. And where will the priority sit?
And no, look, I was going to say that there's a triangle of relationships, US-UK, UK-EU, EU-US, and they're all important. They need to work together. This president, Donald Trump, actually thinks there's only one side of the triangle that appears to be important, and that's Brexit Britain. Now, there are members of the Conservative Party who, looking at the world through the very narrow prism of Brexit, think that Donald Trump has been the best thing since sliced bread. That's a very bizarre way of looking at the world. If one opens the aperture even slightly and considers the true interests of the United Kingdom, I think one would have to conclude, for reasons we could get into, that a Biden administration is much better news, from climate to multilateralism, free trade, dealing with China, sanctions, et cetera, et cetera. But you're right, the EU is going to be a major focus because this president's done so much to undermine our relationship with an essential partner. I was at the center of it for 4 years, almost 4 years, and I saw that even without the UK, the EU27 will remain an essential partner across many areas. So both are important. I don't see it the way you do.
On trade, though, there is talk of a UK-US trade deal being worked on very quickly after Biden comes into office. But there's also talk that the US's priority might be doing a much bigger trade deal with the European Union as a whole. Again, I put it to you, it's about priorities, it's about choices, about perhaps a Joe Biden gut instinct that so-called Britain Trump, that is Boris Johnson, may not be a partner that he wants to get particularly intimate and close with.
No, I don't think so. Look, you're referring to some of the history which will be forgotten. The US and the UK will need to work together. They have to work together for many reasons, you know. And I mentioned a few areas. Climate is a good one, where the UK will be the president of the Conference of Parties next year. And has been very bold in its desire to reduce carbon emissions. But, you know, also on human rights and good governance, anti-corruption, all things very close to the president-elect's heart, the UK has been courageous and outspoken. And I mentioned the other areas, which mean that the UK is a natural partner of the United States. And I haven't even mentioned digital policy, by the way, where the UK has been a thought leader, including in its online paper on harms that come out from, that are related to online platforms. In all of these areas, the UK is an essential partner. Now, you ask me which will be more important. Well, I was at the EU, and I, in terms of economic impact, a deal with the EU would be bigger. But just to be clear, we're not going back to TTIP 2.0, you know, the effort that we never signed to get a US-EU free trade deal. I think we can do a lot with the EU, including eliminating tariffs on industrial goods trade and also on mutual recognition in some sectors. We'll need to see the EU move on agriculture. But the other side of the coin is that there are some areas which will be easier to agree with the UK in free trade. And here I'm thinking about digital policy and also some areas of agricultural policy. So I think both are important.
Let's talk China. Now, when he was vice president, Joe Biden famously got on very well with Xi Jinping and the leaders in Beijing when he went there. Now he's inheriting a relationship which has become pretty poisonous because Donald Trump has said quite plainly, we will no longer accept an exploitative trade relationship with China where they take and we give, and we'll no longer accept their use of technology as a projector of power and influence. It's not going to happen anymore. Will Joe Biden at least acknowledge that Donald Trump maybe was onto something in the nature of the relationship with China?
Well, hang on a minute. Donald Trump didn't discover that China was abusing world trade rules. I think that was well known. And by the way, he didn't achieve much at the end of the day, and that's the acid test. How much did he actually get done? In financial services, to be fair, there appears to have been some opening for U.S. Companies, financial services companies, but generally it's been a failure. He's pushed China into the managed trade area direction of saying, China, just buy more of our stuff and we'll go home happy, right? That's not what we should be doing. We should be addressing the structural issues in this relationship. And as I mentioned before, what's truly bizarre about the last 4 years is that we haven't done this with our closest allies, particularly the EU, with whom we share, actually, a lot in common. So the tactics will be dramatically different. And here's something else.
Yeah, but hang on, just look beyond trade for a moment. I know trade is a great specialism of yours, but let us just think big picture about the way the world works today. The key rivalry, frankly, between the United States and China, which works on so many levels, not just trade, not just technology, but militarily too. Donald Trump got really tough in terms of using the U.S. Navy in the South China Sea, sending a clear message to China there. I'm asking you whether Joe Biden will at least accept that the United States now, strategically, is locked into a long-term confrontation with China.
Well, no, I don't think the confrontation is the word to use. You know, again, Donald Trump didn't invent the importance of the South China Sea and the rights of passage and the importance of, you know, maritime law, international law. That existed before. And, you know, President Obama, my former boss, also was quite robust on that.
Do you really think that Obama's messages on China were as clear as Donald Trump's have been in the last year or two?
Well, you say clear. He didn't insult China, and I don't think we should be in the business of insulting China, because China deserves respect, like every country does. And what importantly was I was going to say is that there are areas where we can work with China, despite the fact that we're going to be tough, I assume, I believe, we're going to be very tough with China where we need to be. But there are areas, including climate, where we must work with China. Remember, part of the reason we got to the Paris Climate Accords together with the EU was that Obama successfully brought the Chinese into the deal, and we're going to need to do that again. So there's no point in just insulting countries, including China, when we need to work with them. The same applies to Russia.
But then I get confused, because as I understand it, one key plank of Joe Biden's different approach to foreign policy is going to be a focus on democracy and human rights. There's talk of holding a summit, a global alliance of democracies, which will be a symbolic moment of change from the Trump agenda. But if you're serious about that, then surely China, Russia are going to have to be viewed with a great deal of suspicion because of their human rights records.
Well, they will be. You're right. I didn't say for a moment, didn't mean to suggest that it's going to be a comfortable relationship. You know, remember, Donald Trump was willing to sell human rights down the river as long as the Chinese would be willing to sell, to buy more of our products. Only when they refused to do that did he discover human rights. That's not going to be the case in this administration. Human rights are going to be a very important pillar. So you're right. It won't be a comfortable relationship. And the uncomfortable light will be shone on human rights abuses where they occur, including the Muslim minority in Xinjiang. But it will be done not in an insulting way. As I say and repeat, China deserves respect. And I think one China policy as well will be reiterated. So there's no point in poking China in those areas. But it will be a difficult in some areas and cooperative in others.
But this is precisely where one wonders what a Biden presidency will really be about. You talk about showing respect in the same breath that you talk about the Chinese policy toward the Uyghurs, which involves detainment, as we understand it, of more than a million people in so-called re-education camps. Again, with Russia, we saw during the last years of the Obama administration, mixed messages on what to do about Russia's activities in Ukraine, the annexation of Crimea, the activities in East Ukraine. Is Biden going to be tougher than Obama was on some of these real challenges? I'm not pretending they're easy, but what can we actually expect from President-elect Biden?
Yeah, but Stephen, you're suggesting a contradiction where I don't think there is a contradiction, because the world is messy. Foreign policy is messy. And with some countries, including Turkey, where the relationship is complicated, in some cases, he will be very tough. There's no doubt. And you mentioned Russia. I think there's unfinished business with Russia. A lot of us from the Obama administration think there is unfinished business with Russia. And you know why. From the last election, where there was clear indication of Russian manipulation intervention in the U.S. Electoral system. I think that is absolutely something we cannot accept. And we can't accept either as civilized countries or democracies that there's a campaign to assassinate political opponents on our soil. So there is unfinished business. Will it be difficult? Absolutely. Are there going to be areas we can cooperate, even with Russia? Absolutely. We need to.
Let's finish with one more arena, and you've alluded to it already, and it's a very interesting one. That is the Middle East. Now, Donald Trump can say that on his watch, he fundamentally changed U.S. policy on key issues like moving the U.S. embassy to Jerusalem, a different approach to a peace process with the Palestinians, which in essence gave Israel the green light to retain settlements on occupied territory in the West Bank, and a very different policy toward Iran, which it seems encouraged Saudi Arabia and the Arab Gulf states to think it worthwhile to reach out to Israel. Now, on all of those arenas, things have changed a lot over the last 4 years. Is Joe Biden going to seek to unpick all of that?
Well, I should repeat, I am obviously speaking as a private citizen, and the Middle East is not my area of expertise. There have been some achievements under this administration. I mentioned what they were. But let's start with Iran. Anyone who thinks that the region is safer because the U.S. walked away from the so-called Joint Comprehensive Plan of Action, the Iran nuclear negotiations, is I think, wrong. It is now less stable. And
well,
now
but there are people who think that very thought. I'm thinking of Ray Tucky, who is a senior fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations. He said this recently: the Trump administration has pursued a successful Mideast policy. It succeeded precisely because it challenged entrenched assumptions, ratcheted up the pressure on Iran, walked away from the JCPOA deal with Iran on the nuclear program, and in essence, he says, has left the Middle East more stable and safer.
No, that's just, I think it's incorrect. The fact is that the Iranians now are pushing the envelope, in fact, more than pushing the envelope, they're violating the agreement, partly because the United States has walked away from it, and they haven't gotten the benefit of the bargain that was announced during the deal, and now they are increasing the official material, as I understand it, and none of that leads to a safer Middle East. The idea that you can have a lasting peace in the Middle East without the involvement of a major partner, which means the Palestinian people themselves, strikes me as rather extraordinary. So no, I don't think the region is any safer today.
A final thought, which is really about overseas perceptions of the United States and its role in the world. You, as you said, have lived in Europe for many years of your life. You've seen changing perceptions of the United States. Donald Trump, I think it's fair to say, has had a huge impact on outsiders' views of the United States in just a four-year presidency. Do you think Joe Biden, in his coming 4 years, will be able to undo all of the perception change that there has been about the United States?
Well, I think about that a lot, because I'm also a European, son of a European, lived in Europe, as you say. These things don't change dramatically, but certainly the mere fact of Biden being president and appointing the people he will appoint, having the policies that he will announce, will give us a window in which to act. We need to seize it. And I'm glad you asked that question, because Europe will also need to ask itself the question, how can it work with the United States in the best possible way? Not giving us freebies, no, we're not asking for that. But think how we can really move forward in the next 4 years to prove the case, as I said before, to prove that working with allies within the system, within the multilateral system that we built after the Second World War, to prove that it's a better way of improving the security and prosperity of our citizens.
Anthony Gardner, we'll revisit it maybe after a couple of years, see how it's going. But for now, thank you very much for joining me on Hard Talk.
Thank you.